ever wonder why they don't start football games with a prayer? Well, as a matter of fact, a lot of times they do. High school, maybe college, even the pros. So they pray for God to give them victory in the game. Very similar to the ancient pagans who had their god was a war god, and they prayed to this god to give them victory in their battles, constant battles and wars. And along came the Christian God, and the Christian God kept winning battles against them. And they said, hey, you know what? Maybe this God's more powerful, so let's switch over, and this is our new God of war. Maybe this God will give us victory in battle. So to this day, they still pray before battles, football games, say, give me strength and courage so we can, you know, defeat the enemy here. Well, whatever they're praying to, it's not God. That is for sure. It's, we don't have a prayer problem, we have a continuity problem. The only action God has ever taken in regard to our deep sleep, our coma, is to create the Holy Spirit. And that's the only action God took, and the Holy Spirit takes it from there, which is to keep everything in its mind. And the Holy Spirit has the capacity to hold everything in place, even though we may drop it, so that we have a soft landing, as it were, an easy awakening. The Holy Spirit's whole purpose is to give us a smooth, easy, gentle awakening from the dream. In other words, solving the continuity problem, which is the fear of an abrupt discontinuity, sudden, instantaneous awakening, where all perception, all thinking, all problems, all form, instantly vanish forever. That's what we're afraid of. Whether we know it or not, that is what we are terrified of. So, you know, maybe people are willing to like have a little hit of it, you know, a little hint. And oh, I felt this oneness. Okay, whew. But the idea of entering into it permanently and forever, instantly, permanently, forever, with, you know, irreversible. No, people don't. Too scared. So, God knows that. We're too scared. Gave the Holy Spirit, created the Holy Spirit for us. The Holy Spirit was not a part of the original creation. But God knew that it would be necessary at some point. So it was concurrent. There was a concurrent creation of the Holy Spirit at the same time, same moment, as we had this whim of trying to be greater than God. Because God knew that would result in a continuity problem. Because we would try to forget about reality, and we would be so adept at doing this that we then would be too afraid to go back to reality, to awaken. We'd have a dream of forgetfulness, and then we'd have too much trouble to awaken from that dream of forgetfulness. And so God created the Holy Spirit concurrent with our decision to dream, actually. Our decision to have dreams of imagination, and all our thinking about things. So we have a safety net, and that's a great, great thing to consider. So here we are, the final play of the Super Bowl. Its final quarter is probably taking place. But we don't have to witness that battle. It's really a mock battle. It's really a mock battle. Hey, you know, it's hear that sound? What's that? What does that sound? That's rain. And rain in California, are you kidding me? Yeah, we're actually getting a few showers right now. Feels really weird. So the mock battle is taking place. And it's just a delaying exercise. So what we're doing is we're actually turning to the root. And we can say, I don't have a prayer problem. I have a continuity problem. You know, we so many people spend so much time in prayer saying, oh God, please help me out. This problem I have is, you know, can you please help this problem? Okay, what's happening there? I'll tell you what's happening there. Is that we have a problem that's really bothering us so bad, and we're terrified that we may get so frustrated with this problem that we're going to decide to junk the whole dream and wake up from it. He says, I've had enough. I'm going to wake up. And we say, oh my gosh, And we get we're not really... The problem creates a bigger problem for us, which is we might want to just awaken abruptly. And so what we're really praying to God is, God, please remove this problem so I don't awaken abruptly. I'm terrified. Can you just lessen it a little bit? You know, that's really what we're praying for. But you say, well, how come God doesn't answer those prayers the way we want? Because God's already given the answer to all prayers in the form of the Holy Spirit. And that is that we'd exchange all our problems for the one problem. So we will not abruptly wake up from the dream. So we can literally drop all other problems other than the continuity problem, which the Holy Spirit holds in place for us by holding everything in its imagination, in its mind. And so we won't vanish. Perception won't vanish. Form won't completely just vanish. The potential for problems still remains, but the actual feeling, the actual problems, those are gone. Those are gone. No more pains, no more suffering. Now, the physical body may deteriorate at some point, but it's not felt as a problem at all. No suffering, no problem really at all. This is how God answers prayer. But our prayer is not appropriate. So when we have a problem, say, hey, God, I don't have this problem. I have a continuity problem. This is the appropriate way to pray. This is what tunes us into God's remedy for us. Instead, everybody's praying, please, I've got this problem. Can you help me out with just this problem? But don't help me out with the others. Leave me some problems. I don't want to. Yeah, just help me out with this one problem here. But the continuity problem remains in place, which means the ego has leverage over us, our mind, which means the ego will continue to feed us problems because it's trying to get us to permanently forget reality. And how do we permanently forget reality except by having more and more problems and more troubles? And we're spinning our wheels, actually. We spend a lifetime simply spinning our wheels. That is what I have seen and observed in this world. Almost everyone comes here, they simply spend an entire life spinning their wheels, and the ego lies to them and says, this is it, once you die, you're finished. Total lie, because the continuity problem remains in the afterlife just the same as it is here. And you will find some way to convince yourself to come back here, because the alternative is too frightening for you. So you want to, oh my God, I need some problems. You come here back to the world and you spin your wheels another life. And it goes on and on and on this way. Incredibly frustrating situation. It was so frustrating, I decided I'm going to find out what the answer is. That's how frustrating it is. But most people just say, well, I can put up with one more life of spinning my wheels. But then the next one comes. You say, well, wait a minute, ego. You said I was finished. And now I'm here again. And the ego says, oh, no, but you're here to help everybody. Oh, okay. And then you end up spinning your wheels another life, and it goes on and on and on. Just nothing but deceit and lies based on fear. Fear of, again, the continuity issue, abrupt discontinuity, permanent. Reality, this whole realm is completely different than reality. It's designed to help us forget reality. It's the whole purpose of this is designed to help us forget reality. This world, planet Crud Coma. Cruel, raw, utter deception. Cruel, raw, utter deception. And we're all comatose here. It's designed to get us to forget reality. And the carrot is that the half-truths, we think we could have something better than reality called half-truths, kingdom of half-truths. And I don't think anybody watching the Super Bowl is really focused on this, which means they're spinning their wheels. They'll continue to spin their wheels. Eat, drink, and be merry, and take their chances. But it's not, chances is not what's happening. For sure, as long as you have the continuity problem, you will continue to incarnate into a place of severe forgetfulness. No question about it. Now don't run over to the TV. And I gotta check out what's going on, what's going on. Because this is more interesting, because you heard the way prayer, the way we've been doing it, doesn't work. It's kind of like opposite of what we should be doing. We should be saying, I don't have this problem. I have a continuity problem, and that's the only problem I have. Aligning with God's remedy, and then let's see what happens. So I'll see what happens in my life. I had some bad dreams last night. I was really despondent. But again, I don't have a despondency problem. I have a continuity problem. Hey, the cat's coming out of the ring, huh? I don't have a despondency problem. I have a continuity problem. The continuity problem is the real despondency problem. So put your attention where the problem really is, and then you will value the solution where it really is, you see? It's about valuing. Your attention is based on valuing. Our attention is based on valuing, right? I mean, everybody you see, where's their attention? It's interesting. I go around the world, and I look at people, and it's like they have lives, and there's a lot of attention and focus. But it's their lives seem like ships in the night. It depends what they value. That's what they're seeing. A lot of times, I've noticed that I'm not even seen by people. Don't even show up on their radar at all, because they don't value what I stand for at all. It's a very interesting thing. So where your value, what you believe has value for you, that is where your attention is going to be. What do you say? Where your treasure is, there shall your mind be, your heart be. Very, very true. So we have to change our valuing so that the mind will pay attention to that. So the continuity problem, turning in that direction, we will recognize the vision of oneness, which is the only value there really is. That's the remedy for the continuity problem. And that's the only value there is. Nothing else in the universe has any value. No value whatsoever. But the vision of oneness does have value. And you wonder, why don't people see it? Because they see value elsewhere. Because of their fear of abrupt awakening, they see value in forgetting reality and in hiding deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper in darkness, into a deep, deeper, deeper, deeper coma. And people, you can see they're working on their coma during the day. Look at people and say, wow, they're really working on their coma today, intensely. And you really can't just casually tell them the truth, you know, when you meet people, because it scares them, because they start waking up and they say, wow, what are you doing? I don't want to wake up. I want to get into a deeper coma here. And they get terrified. That's what I experienced when I was younger. I thought, let me just tell people the truth directly when I'm with them. And instead of being thanked, people got extremely angry and hostile towards me, because they were terrified. But I didn't explain the continuity problem to him. I just explained, look, this is, you know, you can awaken in reality. I just sort of, at that time, I was not aware of the continuity problem as I am now. Didn't have such a severe one. When you first come into this world, coming back to this world, it's not quite as strong. But very quickly, when you're in this world, it very quickly gets into you severely. And of course, you're carrying it over from previous lives too. So the seed is like, the seed is there, and then the plant grows again, right? It gets watered. It comes in here and gets watered and fertilized. You may have pruned it back a bit in the afterlife, but it springs, grows again, like a plant in springtime, suddenly, you know, bursting into great growth, vigorous growth. And then you got a really severe continuity problem here. So yeah, I got really assailed badly in many ways by trying to help people here. They don't want to wake up, but that's just fine because the continuity problem, you're not awake yet. You're having a very blissful dream that gently allows you to finally wake up. So this is, from my experience, this way of teaching is absolutely crucial. Otherwise, people will actually go into a deeper coma. They'll be frightened. Even if they make some progress, sudden progress, they will tend to slip down. I know there's some people who actually have said they've awakened, and then months later or something, they hold it for a little while, and then some devastating illness comes back, and they lose it. They lose it. It's too much for them. They don't have the sufficient understanding of context to be able to hold it and stay with it for some reason. So others have a glimpse, then they go deep into a coma. They just flee, just flee, and they say, oh my gosh. So you have to work at it every day. That's why I'm saying every dayness is the key. You don't want to retreat back into fear, because those retreats can be very deep. And even now, I have to guard against retreating too much into fear, because when I have breakthroughs and see it more clearly, then there's a tendency to go back and try to, hide somewhere, get your mind occupied with some images, things, forms, distractions. And you have to watch that and just say, whoa, wait a minute, stop listening to all that music, It's you're slight backsliding. So backsliding happens. I say two steps forward, usually you slide one step back. You just try to minimize it. Don't slide two steps back. Don't slide three steps back. I mean, really, you just say, okay, I'm sliding one step back, and let's just watch it, and then let's make another push forward. So that's what I've discovered, is two steps forward and one step back on the path is generally what happens. Now, the further you go, the steps are bigger, and the backsliding gets less, actually. Now it might be like five steps forward and one step back or something like that. So it improves, but you just have to be aware you will backslide, because you say, well, wait a minute, that might be a little too much progress. I'm not sure. Let me back off a little bit. I don't want anything abrupt taking place. Let me back off a little bit. And you do that. Let me adjust, and then you say, okay, everything seems to be okay. So I will I'll go forward a little bit more. Just keep that in mind. Little adjustments here on the fly. The benefit of daily effort is you become aware of the dynamic of the path. And so you manage it better. You manage it way better. You don't backslide so much. And you make much better progress. It gets smoother. Whereas if you just kind of do it occasionally, like you go to retreat sometime, you're out of shape. You don't recognize the dynamic of it, and you'll end up repeating the same experience over and over and over and over and over again, really. And people say, well, yeah, I don't have much time for the, I can schedule something in August and I'll go on a 3-day retreat or something and like that. That's not going to get the job done. You have to be a spiritual multitasker, meaning that you are practicing every day. Every day. It has to be seamless. You don't want to skip a day. And you may, but I certainly don't. You just use everything. Everything is grist for the mill of practice. So when you're driving, whatever you're engaged in, and there's no excuses, you have to maintain the sense of objectivity and managing the path and being aware when you're getting off track and say, no value to that. Catch it, catch it quickly, no value to that. And get back and say, I have a continuity problem. No value to that, I have a continuity problem. And just keep practicing. When I get into my vehicle in the morning, instead of punching the radio on, I punch the MP3 recorder on, and then I'm driving, I'm recording it to someone. And that's a very good focus, is trying to explain it to somebody very clearly. You have to get your thoughts very clear. Your awareness has to be very clear. Otherwise, you can't do it. You'll stumble and lose train of thought and everything. So, you know, no radio. Now, here's something very interesting I have to share that is an amazing thing. Jesus said, love your enemies. Well, his interesting take on this is that I discovered that the people you dislike the most, your so-called enemies, etc., actually can be the most helpful people in your lives. And you may say, what in the world are you talking about? Right. Well, here's an example. I have this problem where I listen to this sports talk show when I'm driving, because it's a frivolous, fun way to waste your time as you're driving. And they brought this new person in, like a third wheel in. And I really couldn't stand them. You know, they're so crass and crude and degenerate. I just can't stand their persona. Just detestable. You know, I just say, this is just slime, very slimy person. And so what happened was I stopped listening to the program. I couldn't take it anymore. So I said, no, I can't. I'm not going to subject myself to this. And in doing so, I stopped listening to the radio altogether. I said, I got used to just not even turning it on. So once I'd turn it on in the morning and that'd get me going, right, for the day. Now I don't turn it on at all. I hit the MP3 recorder. And so that slimy personality literally helped me out immensely, because now my full attention has been on the recording. And that's when I really made the recent, you know, tremendous breakthroughs, actually. I'm giving it much more effort now. So that quote-unquote enemy actually turned out to be an incredible help to me. Now, here's another example, a bigger example. Let's take the president, for example. Now, when I first saw the president back in, what was it, the debates in 2008 or something, I saw one debate, said, let me, I don't know who this is, I have no idea who it is, let me just listen. Everybody's all excited, and I listened carefully, and I said, oh my gosh, you know, this guy has a severe ego problem, and he's rationalizing and justifying the way his mind works. It's a big, big problem. Really, really big problem. This mind is very much out of kilter, and he's able to just rationalize stuff in his mind to himself just terribly, and expect everybody else is just going to accept his rationalizations. And I said, I'm not paying any more attention to this guy. Well, he went on to be the president, and still is the president. And I really find his mind to be so unpalatable, that I literally tuned out politics. Never listened to anything he has to say. And the fact he's on the news constantly everywhere, I gradually just pushed the news farther and farther away. So I don't want to have anything to do with the news at all. And it's just, I can't stand it. And the result is, you know, I don't pay any attention to the news anymore. And it's been a gradual process, really. But at this point, no, I don't even know what's going on. I don't care. And so that's actually been a gigantic help to my life. Gigantic. Because there's nothing worse than getting enmeshed in the news, really. It pulls you into the radio. It pulls you in the newspaper, the internet. It pulls you into television. It pulls you into discussions, fruitless discussions about politics, etc. So the fact that I find this person's mind to be very unpalatable, and I don't have anything to do with this mindset, actually freed me up to an extraordinary extent, you see? So there again, you see somebody that you really don't want anything to do with, actually turns out to have helped you, your life, immensely, immensely. So, you know, there was that book by Mitch Albom, I think, Five People You Meet in Heaven. I didn't read it, but I heard people explain it to me. When you know, the five people you meet in heaven, they may be your worst enemies, the people you detested the most. Because in detesting them so much, you decided to keep your distance from them. And in doing keeping your distance from him, you ended up keeping your distance from a whole lot of other stuff that you wouldn't have distanced yourself otherwise. I mean, it's incredible. Is it, you know, I actually look at the president as one of the greatest helpers in the world. He's making everything so terrible that actually, I'm like just saying to the whole world, I said, I'm not even interested in the world anymore. That's actually true. I mean, this whole situation has been going on the last 8 years, actually before that too, the Bush years too, has made the world, the whole mood of the world so terrible that I have no interest in it anymore. I said, forget it, not even interested. That's a great thing. I remember Don Juan and Carlos Castaneda's books saying, you know, the best thing is a petty dictatorship where the country is, everybody hates what's going on, it's terrible. He said, that is the most helpful thing, actually. Because then you say, forget it, I'm not interested in this world, or it's terrible. And then you focus on for your freedom. And so we have that. So actually, you know, it's very paradoxical. It's very paradoxical. Maybe the president thinks he's saving the world. He thinks he's a savior. You know, he's got a messiah complex, for sure. But not in the way he actually is saving. He is a savior, but not in the way that he thinks at all. It's that people are so desperate to distance themselves from him that they want to ascend. So I'm not sure that's what he wants, but that's how it's working out. So yeah. I mean, you know, actually, I have a lot of gratitude for my enemies. I do love my enemies, so to speak. Because they're the most helpful ones of all. And like, look at the Super Bowl. You know, that's an enemy too. Really, it is. It's an enemy of everyone. Because it puts us deeper into a coma. And what am I doing now? I'm avoiding it. And I'm putting emphasis on this taping to share to the whole world. And that's helping me out immensely. See? So Jesus said, love your enemies. There's a new take on love your enemies, isn't it? It's a very pragmatic take on it. Very pragmatic. And, you know, your friends are usually the people that actually are your worst influences, because they actually help pull you down in a friendly way. Like, oh yeah, let's do this. I got somebody to waste time with, basically, is who your friends are. But your enemies, you say, oh, I'm not going to have anything. Are they there? I'm not going there then. Oh, they're going to this party? Oh, forget it. I'm not going. And then you miss the party, and it's great. You spend time, maybe you spend time in contemplation and meditation, in the continuity technique. You spend time with the continuity technique. I have a continuity problem. Continuators Anonymous. And you make incredible progress. And you say, what a blessing. If they hadn't have been at the party, I would have gone there. See, if they wouldn't have been there, I would have gone. But since they went there, I didn't go. Wonderful. Wonderful. So it's actually a great help in your life if you have these antagonists in your life. And God knows we have a great antagonist now in the White House, and actually as a pope also. Very great antagonists that we say, whoa, you know, no, I don't want that. I don't want that. The pope says, forget about theology. Forget about that. Just redistribute the wealth, you know. What? Forget about theology. So, oh my gosh, I don't want this. And so I focus even more intently on theology, which is all important. Because you have to understand that we want to be greater than God, therefore thinking that we're going to want to deprive God of the nature of reality, actually, which is oneness, seamless oneness, because we're going to separate from it. And then we're terrified that we're going to lose everything. We projected that onto God and now think that God is trying to dispossess us of everything. And therefore we're desperate, this incredible terror, and we're trying to hide from that, and we're trying to forget all about reality, a dream of forgetfulness, and establish a kingdom of half-truths. That's theology. And that's totally essential. And then God, having been engaged in this hiding from God, we have a continuity problem. God created the Holy Spirit specifically to solve the continuity problem for us so we can awaken from this dream of forgetfulness. That is theology. And that is all important. All important. So we're being told to forget about theology. And I say, whoa, well, let's better focus even more on it, right? Absolutely. And we're being taught that everything's okay. you know, basically saying, any style of coma you want's okay, you know, it's all good. Yeah. Missing the straight and narrow path. Jesus said, very straight and narrow path to salvation. In other words, your focus, your valuing has to be in the right place. And now we're being told, do whatever you want to do. It doesn't matter. It's all good. It's all okay. As long as you come to church and support the institutions, you know, well, what do we care? As long as we have this inclusivity of going towards half-truths, why do we need theology? What do we need theology for? It's nonsense, you know, that stuff. So it's like an eye-opener. You say, well, holy cow, they're trying to take the most valuable thing in the world away from us. So we better really focus in on it. So that's a help. The antagonists are helpful. Very, very helpful. That's why when I come across an antagonist, I always thank them. You know, I'm actually happy. You know, well, not entirely, because it is, you know, but deep down I say, you know what, this is probably very, very helpful. Let's not be hostile in this way. Let's just keep working. This is someone's coming in my life to help me focus even more stringently. Now, like an illness can be an antagonist that's very helpful, because I've been through so many severe illnesses that I couldn't hardly function. All I could do was just sit in a chair. And in doing so, I said, what can I do? And I said, I can look at my thoughts, right? What else? So, but I can read. And so I do those. I'd read, and then I'd look at my thoughts, read, and just did that. And in doing so, I got very adept at discipline in doing this. If I hadn't been sick, no way would I have done that. That is for sure. If and another guy lost my eyesight, went very bad when I was young. If it hadn't gotten really bad, I definitely would have pursued like a sports career, like in baseball. I was very, very good in baseball because I was intuitive and I kind of knew what was going to happen. Like I had it faster than other people. So I was aware what the pitcher was going to do, what everything people were going to do. And it was just like on top of the whole game mentally. I had the mental edge on everybody. But my eyes went so bad, I couldn't see properly, and so I had to stop. So, you know, and then, so everything, that you get blocked, and again, like surfing, my ears got swimmer's ear, got the bones. I was surfing in super cold water, and the bones grew in my ears to try to block off, keep the water from coming in, and then the water get trapped, and I got constant infections. I had to stop swimming, and I haven't been in the water for maybe 20, 35 years. I can't go in the water. I used to spend all my time in the water, love the water. So I would have led a surfing life, like an endless summer life, if it hadn't have been for that ear problem. And at the time, it was like catastrophic, terrible. So when God blocks your life, and the Holy Spirit like blocks your life, you know, it's terrible. But, you get a lemon, you make a lemonade out of it. It actually works to your advantage. So the reason why I'm able to get to this clarity is because I've been blocked so severely, actually. Very severely. All the stuff that I loved doing was taken away from me. And then, I loved music and wanted to perform. And I couldn't get any, nothing worked. I couldn't get any traction in the music field. It was just horrible. I said, what is going on? You know, can't get any traction, can't meet the right people, can't get the right connections, nothing works out. And so, basically, that went nowhere, which was a great thing. Then I tried singing. I tried that, and that went nowhere too. I said, "Wow, everything got blocked," and that's not pleasant. You think the world's against you. You think that God doesn't love you. Why is God blocking everything that I love? He prevents me from doing. Now there is this ideology that do what you love and you'll be happy, but I take exception to that, really. I mean, I don't agree necessarily with everything that Jesus says, like in A Course in Miracles. I mean, I'm secure enough to disagree with certain things, which is okay. But, you know, follow your joy and everything will be fine. Well, I found that all my joy that I tried to follow got blocked, and I couldn't follow it. And that actually worked out to my advantage. So, I mean, what I'm doing now is, I mean, I'd rather be out playing golf today. Well, what happened? I got a bad back. I can't play golf, really. Every time I try, I get severe problems and numbness. I'm getting numbness in my arms because my back tightens up and nerves get pinched. So what I'm doing, I'm taping. So taping is work, you know, it is hard work. So I would say, do what's the hardest work for you, that you really have to focus in on truth, and then that will succeed. A lot of people, I see them just living the lives they think is happy, you know. They're like, let's have a barbecue on the patio today, and oh, we got some great food, isn't this wonderful? Oh, what kind of wine do we have, you know? And oh, I need to paint this area of my house, I got a nice house. And really, is that really solving this, getting to the root of the problem? No, it's not. So follow your joy. Then you think if it gets cut off, then you get bitter towards God. I would much rather say, accept the blocks that come into your life. Love your enemy, love your blocks, love the blockage that comes into your life, because it's actually redirecting you towards what's very important. It's redirecting you towards right focus. Otherwise, your focus would be off on other stuff, no question about it. And then again, you know, I had situations where my appearance deteriorated. And, you know, wearing glasses, big, thick, huge glasses. And before that, I was very popular in school, actually. And then my eyes went bad, and I got these big glasses, and I was uncoordinated, and I felt weird and, like, nerdy. Lost my popularity. And other issues arose late in my life that literally, if these things hadn't have arisen, I would have been very narcissistic and into my appearance. You know, thinking that I can get through life, you know, and all my charm and good looks and all this stuff. And I'm sure I would have attracted a lot of attention in that way. And my life would have been utterly different, totally different, actually. So that's a blessing. I mean, if you're not attractive, that's a great blessing, actually, in this world. Great blessing. And the ones that are very attractive, that's a curse. It's really a very bad curse, actually. Because they just think, oh, all I need that nice white, even smile, you know, just smile and just look beautiful and dress beautiful and be have nice manners and pleasantness, etc. And everything falls into your lap and that's it, you're comfortable. But the ones who are not attractive at all, they don't have friends, they just what do? Oh my gosh, I gotta focus in on why am I so miserable? Why am I so unhappy? And they gradually, you know, come to some great clarifications. So that's a super blessing to not be attractive in this world. So I got all these super blessings in my life, but I didn't see them as super blessings at the time. In fact, I felt they were curses, actually. And now this, I'm in a situation where I've got the fear of deprivation in the future is just gigantic. It seems like, you know, everything's just completely drying up as far as support, and it's like, you know, it's just like falling off the edge of the world. But that's causing me to, like, just do an intense, you know, focus on the continuity technique and the valuing technique, like a race against time. It's kind of like there's this finish line where I better finish up here, because the future looks incredibly bleak. And I've had like a situation of severe financial deprivation my entire life, but over the last 10 years it's just been hideous, and that has caused me to again work as so incredibly hard at trying to finish and find out how can I free myself from these problems, you know. Whereas if I had money, for sure, I would have led a very different life, for sure. I would have been traveling, you know, playing golf, going to resorts, whatever, just living the good life that a lot of other people are living, actually, in this area, for sure. They take vacations constantly, and they're living the good life. Now, for sure, I would have done that, for sure. I mean, let's be honest, you know, if we have money, we're going to enjoy the money. So not having any money at all, disposable income at all, forced me. I had nothing. I can't go anywhere. I can't do anything. So here I am, Super Bowl Sunday, taping, doing this taping. Can't even afford to play golf right at this moment. So that works to my advantage, doesn't it? Absolutely, it has. It's kept me desperately striving. So your problem, those are your greatest allies, actually. And not that you like them, though. It's very uncomfortable. But you make the best of them. Make lemonade out of those lemons. And before you know it, you got this wonderful pitcher of lemonade, and it's hot, and you drink it. This tastes great. Pretty interesting, isn't it? Now get back to Jesus and say, follow your joy. Well, I'm sure what he has to say in his context is correct. There's no question about it. I'm not questioning that. I'm just saying that what I have to say here in this context is also very valid. That's what I'm saying is very valid. It's your enemies that provide the greatest help. It's the thorn in your side. There might be someone who's a real thorn in your side, and that actually is very, very helpful. You may not dislike them intensely, but it helps you focus your mind better. There's nothing that dissipates your life worse than luxurious ease, where you have this money and you can just kind of, fritter your life away. And I know someone that lived down south among the real rich Southern California people. Okay, and they know the families, the whole scene down there, incredible wealth actually in certain areas of Southern California. Just obscene wealth there. There's so much money, old money. Money's just kids grow up with massive trust funds and stuff. They don't have to do anything, so they just fritter their lives away, and they all most of them become raging alcoholics or drug addicts. They have severe problems. Severe problems, really. It's because they don't have to work. And they don't have to worry about anything. They got all the money in the world. And they can just go wherever they want to go, do whatever they want to do. And they just end up, the wheels just come off very badly. And a lot of them are very attractive, very attractive people. And they dress, very attractively. And they have all the great connections. And they, they got their yachts and all this stuff. And they're just like miserable. So it's really a blessing to not have much money in this world. Now, in my case, I always feel, hey, maybe it's too much of a blessing, hey, it's too tight, too stressful, for sure. But that puts the heat on. And so this will result in me never coming back to the world, whereas those who are dissipating, they have all this money and stuff, they never feel like they need to apply themselves, this way. And they come back again. They come again, They keep returning. So when you have a life where you're a non-returner, then everything gets blocked, in my opinion. It all gets blocked, and your life here just feels terrible. And if you say, I don't want to come back here for sure. No way. Never. And then you have to find out then the continuity problem is the only problem I really have. That's how what you have to do. Buddhism has a very useful model. They're saying they have like the frequent returners, the ones that are going to keep coming back. They're going to have a lot of cycles still of lives. And they have different categories. I don't know. They have the stream enterer, the ones that start entering the stream of grace, where they start turning their attention towards eventual liberation from this planet called coma and this terrible nightmare of trying to forget reality. So they'll have several more lives. Once they enter the stream, they'll have some more, maybe two, three, four more lives, and then they'll eventually get free, liberated. Then they have the once returner, where there's a person that comes in and they're pretty focused, but they're not quite ready, and they're going to come back one more time to this world. And then they have the no returners, where this is their last life. This is their final life. And I realized I was a final returner. This is my final life. when I was young. I knew it. But I also knew this life is going to be very tough because everything gets blocked. Everything, you can't get any traction in this world at all. You can't make friends, you can't have connections, you can't have success, you can't have money, you can't have good looks, you can't have talent, you can't have a good career. On and on and on and on and on. You just can't connect with the world anymore. It gets blocked, everything, nothing works. And then that causes you to say, wow, I better find that some other place. This isn't happening for me. And then you find, you know, you turn to the vision of oneness. And you know, I have a continuity problem, the vision of oneness. And you keep focusing on that. I haven't got it yet, but my focus is better and better and better on it for sure. Once you get the vision of oneness, you're a no-returner. That is for sure. But that's the scary part, you know. I'm thinking like, oh my gosh, do I really want to never return here? And the answer is yes, I don't want to return here for sure. But it still seems like a very irreversible situation. But in fact, it's reality that's irreversible. Now, there's the listeners to these videos. There's some that are stream enterers. There's some that are once returners, and there's some, maybe some that are you know, no returners. Final life, that's very possible. So there is a variety, and then there's a few that have not yet entered the stream, and they're just, what is this? Huh? This is weird. But it may help them actually be stream enterers at some point, maybe their next life, or maybe later in this life they'll enter the stream because they'll realize, hey, there is a stream there. You know, there is a stream there. Something to enter. I really can enter into this. There, you know, it does make sense. There's a reason. It's reasonable. It's pragmatic. It's clear. But yeah, the world can become totally unpalatable. That is for sure. So thank God for the enemies, your adversaries in this world. The ones that you really don't like, they're helping make the world a terrible place. Thank God for the techies and the fourth dimensional, you know, they're making this world so unpalatable. I just said, wow, don't want to be here for this you know, nanny state, this big mother state world, globalization of monitoring and control, and the leveling, the homogenization of society so we can all agree in the goal of half-truths together. Together, we have a half-truth. You know, wow. So he says, I don't want coming back for that. So that lights a fire. Lights a fire. But I need more fire, you know. I need to be lit more because I still haven't succeeded. And you have to use your will, and you have to start saying, wait, I don't need the Super Bowl. I don't need the Super Bowl. Forget it. That's just going to drag me back into a coma. And, you know, I can't afford to be in a coma. You know, that's the truth. I cannot afford it. I cannot afford to be in a coma. Because the future, financial future for me, it looks like it's a cliff, you know. So I think there's a lot of people that can relate to that in some ways. Now, maybe not as severe as my situation, but you know, there's like there's a cliff. I think a lot of people's lives, there's some kind of cliff there, right? You know, it's the overall thing. It could be your health, it could be your earning capacity, it could be your savings, it could be your retirement, it could be just a depression, an illness, a disenchantment with the world. All these kinds of things. You see a cliff ahead of you, and you're just like, wow, I'd better buckle down and work extra hard on all this stuff. And don't be like a cat just sleeping all day. You can't be like the cat. I keep telling the cat, I said, wake up, don't sleep, you're sleeping your life away. I'm dreaming my life away, looking for a better way for me. But you're not going to find a better way by sleeping your life away. You're going to have to say, I don't have a prayer problem. I have a continuity problem. I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. I accept the fact that I have a continuity problem. I accept the fact that I have a continuity problem. I'm grateful for the Holy Spirit and holding everything in place for me. I'm grateful for the potential problematic nature of the vision of oneness, the potential problematical nature, because it doesn't ever turn into actual problem. Doesn't turn into, because the oneness is there, and that oneness reminds us of reality. No matter what the dance of forgetfulness is, the vision of oneness reminds us of reality. It doesn't matter what the dance is. This is very important. That's why you don't have to change the world. It doesn't matter what the dance of forgetfulness is, how it's dancing, whatever it's doing, the cha-cha or the marenga or the foxtrot or the two-step or the cha-cha, the samba, the swim, the boogaloo. It doesn't matter. The twist. Everybody's twisting our life away. Yeah, twisting the life away. It doesn't matter, because the vision of oneness sees it all as one, and it reminds us of reality. It doesn't matter what the dance is. It makes no difference. It's a very crucial point, actually. This is a very advanced level we're at right now. It doesn't matter what the dance is. And the more that sinks in, very powerful. You know, when it sinks in, you know, you realize you're free of existence, because it doesn't matter what the dance is like. It makes no difference. It makes no difference to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit draws no distinctions between any of the dancing of forgetfulness. It just shows you this vision of oneness, smoothed out sameness. It's all one, all one, all smoothed out. So, it's irrelevant what the dance is. It doesn't affect you. It doesn't affect remembrance in the slightest way. Whether the whole planet could be plunged into severe warfare, it wouldn't affect your remembrance in the slightest bit. Or the whole planet could be plunged into peace, it wouldn't affect your remembrance in the slightest bit. Because of the vision of oneness, this perfect overlay, as it were, perfect sameness, this perfect realization the Holy Spirit gives to us. And we've covered this in many, many, many videos, and I'll get into it again, maybe soon, of exactly what that is, but I'd rather experience it first so I can give first-hand testimony to it. Up to this point, I've been using reason to very clearly identify it, but experiencing it would be even better. It doesn't matter what dance is taking place in the whole universe. Makes no difference. The vision of oneness, smoothed out sameness, pure consciousness, pure awareness, pure spaciousness, that is totally unaffected by any dance of forgetfulness, any form, untouched by any form. It's this pure, perfect, non-crystallized untouchedness by any form. And so the dances, if it's untouched by any form, then the dance is a form. How can that touch it? Can a dance of form touch it? If it's untouched by form, how could the dances of form touch it? It doesn't. So, it doesn't matter. Let whatever comes, let it happen. Just let it happen. Let the world dance. You are remembering the nature of reality, wherein it's impossible to reverse reality. It's irreversible. The nature of reality is irreversible. It's unchangeable. It's untouchable. It cannot be transcended. Cannot be separated from. Cannot be changed, and cannot be divided or fragmented or anything like that. You remember that. It can only be known. Since it is one, it's known, directly known. You remember that from this experience of the form is still dancing, but your experience of this oneness, this seamless, non-crystallized, equal oneness, this Christness, is untouched by the dance, no matter what the dance is. So it doesn't matter who wins the Super Bowl, does it? No. This oneness is untouched by it. Your remembrance is untouched by anything that happens in the world. maybe I can make a video. I don't know. It's using some pictures of a great teacher showing up, and they're in that mood. But I have a feeling people can't kind of quite relate. I'd have to narrate it somehow. But maybe I can try it. We'll see. But people seem to tend to like these videos more than my videos with pictures and stuff. So. Doesn't matter. Let us think. It doesn't matter what makes no difference to the Holy Spirit. Draws no distinctions. Why draw distinctions among illusions, among dreams? This is completely unnecessary. It's better to see that none of it touches reality at all. It doesn't influence. So this vision of oneness, it doesn't touch this vision of oneness. It's a miracle by the Holy Spirit. And this reminds us of the nature of reality. So we really don't need to know what's going on. It's unimportant. It's totally unimportant. Now, in the past, of course, there wasn't, before radio, television, movies, newspapers, all this stuff, people didn't have any news. The news was local in the village or whatever. And they weren't thinking about all the world events. Nobody knew what was going on in other parts of the world. So. Right now, with this, you know, instant news going onto your dumb phone of people tweeting about every last possible thing that's taking place and their impressions of it, and you get all this news feed that you're constantly up to date on you know, what's happening in Sudan, what's happening in Syria, what's happening in China, what's happening in the Philippines, what's happening in the U.S., what's happening in India, what's happening in Argentina, what's happening in Germany, Europe, East, the West, what's happening in our state, you know, local. Everything is this massive pipeline of constant news flowing into us. And we get caught up in this feeling of importance. We get the magazines, we get the internet news, some of us get newspapers. We think that this is very important. We're up to date on everything. I was brought up that way, be very up to date on all world affairs. And I found it was just this massive concern that was just, couldn't do anything about any of this stuff. It was just horrible. But when you realize that none of it matters as far as remembering reality, it makes no difference, then you it's easier to drop it. And I've been dropping it more and more and more and more and more. Rarely do I ever tune into the news. I take a glance maybe at the front page of the newspaper. Maybe just kind of very quickly, a few headlines. Sometimes not, but sometimes, you know, the weather, news about the weather, what's the weather going to be like? You know, try to just leave it at that, actually. So I don't completely shut myself off. You know, it's not, no obsession or anything like that. If there's a newspaper, I might glance at the headline or not. But I'm not following any story. Not following any story, really. That's important. I dropped the Schumacher thing for like 3 weeks or something. And I just heard trying to take him out of coma. But I'm not following. I'm not looking for the headlines, you know. That's a significant, I got a feeling it's a significant indicator of what's to come in this world, actually. Very interesting situation. Pointed out the unbelievable cruelty of this world and just wow. That you know, a billionaire, one of the most famous athletes in the world, one of the most recognizable people in the world in many ways, and maybe one of the greatest philanthropists in the world, okay, and the greatest race car driver that's ever lived, all of those things, and by all accounts a very, very nice person, good person. At least off the racetrack, he was too aggressive on the racetrack for a lot of people's tastes. But that he would be skiing with friends, and this little girl, daughter of one of the friends, goes off track a little bit and falls, but not in a harmful way or anything. He just goes, "Oh, let me go help her up." And so he went off the piste or whatever it is, piste, and he's just going to pick the little girl up, and suddenly he flips upside down, hits a rock. Somehow there's a hidden rock, flipped upside down, lands on his head on some other rock, breaks his helmet and crushes his skull, and he may be a vegetable for the rest of his life. You know, this billionaire, great philanthropist, greatest, all this stuff in this person, and the national icon, ends up, in a second, he suddenly whoop upside down, smashes his head. That's it for him, vegetable. Hopefully not, but it could be very likely. It's like the essence of cruelness, isn't it? The essence of cruelness. That should be shocking to people. Doesn't matter. You could be the biggest icon in the world. Look what happens to you. He was definitely one of the bigger icons in the world. And look what happened to him. Trying to help somebody. Just out of the, just a helpful nature. I'm just going to help out. And treacherous hidden rock. You know, never saw it. Never saw it coming. Never saw it coming. And instantly, that's it. His life is he's turned into a vegetable. And just think about that. If you think this world's a great place, just think about that. The problem is most people don't think about it. Why? Because they want to get rid of this world altogether. And that, what happens? Fear of the continuity problem causes them to say, oh yeah, it's awful, but I don't want to think about it. Because they'd want to chuck all the problems. Say, I hate this world. This is I hate this whole situation. I want to get rid of it forever. I never want to see it ever again. And then they say, whoa, it's too abrupt. And so they say, I don't want to think about this anymore. That's exactly what happens. And the news people know that. They keep feeding us this awful news. And we say, yeah, that's terrible. And then they say, oh, wait a bit, but I don't want to chuck it all. Is there something else, some other problem? Oh, here's another problem. And so we get addicted to the news. The news is very addicting, actually. Severe addiction. Yeah, there's so many addicts. It was a world full of addicts and pushers that know how to push the addiction on everybody. There's no question about it. Because they know, we all know subconsciously we have this very severe continuity problem. And the world, what it does, it exploits it. The ego just exploits it. It exploits it instead of clarifying it. So you have those who clarify and those who exploit. Big difference between the two. And then, of course, the ego says, hey, let's combine the two into a half-truth. Which is why the clarifiers get used, really, in this world. Unless they are, bodhisattvas, saints, true, already enlightened, and they happen to come back to this world because that they're seeing that they can be helpful here, that the Holy Spirit tells them that there's a way to be helpful. That's the only way you would come back here, you'd want to come back here, that the Holy Spirit actually sees, tells you very clearly that the opportunity is there, actually, that there are those who are going to truly, be benefited from it instead of just being used by the ego as a foil for the exploiters to then turn everybody in the direction of half-truth, okay? Because the ego will say, oh, look, they're saying you got to drop the world, and they're saying you got to embrace the world. And the ego says, hey, you know what? I think we can have the best of both of those. Let's not do either, but let's make a half-truth out of those two. Let's both kind of feel like we can drop some problems, but indulge in other ones, and let's have a half-truth, and we have a new kingdom here. And so the ego is playing both sides against each other and manipulating the people, the mentality here, to go keep believing in that half-truths are the best solution. It's like the people who run the gambling institutions, they set the sports line so they get equal bets on both sides, and then they make the vigorous, they make a percentage of every bet made. So the more bets they can get, the more money they make. So they try to get equal bets on both sides. Those are the ones who are really exploiting the situation here. Very badly. And there is that mentality in the world of those who are very adept at trying to get the line so that you get equal people on both sides, and then you can exploit the whole thing about half truths. They say, look, it's stalemated here. Neither one of you can win. So here's this. Let's amalgamate them. Let's integrate them into a half truth. That kind of thing. So we want kind of equal pressure on both sides, is, you know, get those, they let's ascend. Others say, no, let's descend. And they say, okay, let's amalgamate those two together. And let's just make a compromise, integrate, compromise, half-truth, problem solved, you know, that kind of thing. The so-called peacemakers, you have one faction over here, another faction over here. You know, they say like the people, war is very profitable for certain industries, isn't it? They actually try to supply both sides, or at least you may get like one group of armament producers and then another in collaboration. They may collaborate and say, let's start a war, and we'll supply one side, you supply the other side, we'll both get super rich. Absolutely, that happens. Easy to stir up animosities in places, and you know, the different suppliers may be a cartel, actually. Maybe a cartel, and the whole cartel is getting super rich by supplying both sides of the conflict. But there really is that level of cynicism here in the world. The world runs on that. That's the you know, half-truths is the heart of this planet, Planet Grudkoma. They're half-truths. So they want spiritual teaching in the world to balance out the you know, degeneracy, so that they can say that, hey, there's a stalemate. You know, neither side can win. They say, keep it going, keep the world going to get richer. Keep the conflict going, keep people more and more addicted. And that's easier to steer them into them worshiping half-truths. And say, well, we've got the stalemate, so let's have a compromise. And we'll extract massive worship and obedience from, you know, we being the peacemakers coming in and fashioning this compromise. We're the great historical figures, etc. Very tricky, this world. Yeah, they want games, close games that draw interest of people and say, who's going to win? They want to get a lot of gambling, a lot of betting on both sides. That's where it's all about, is to get people to think like, hey, you know, maybe this side's gonna win. And then an equal number of people say, no, maybe this side's gonna win. So polarization is very important in this world, of keeping the world polarized, so there then can be a greater and greater belief in half-truths. Let's just put truth and lies together, and we got the best of both. The idea that we can get the best of both, is what keeps us imprisoned, because it's based on the fear of continuity problem, of dropping the whole thing, the whole stupid dream altogether. And this through and through, the whole society is this way. If you have an elite who are the manipulators of both sides, like they support both candidates, like in a presidential election, no matter who wins, they're going to succeed even more and more and more and more power, that kind of thing. Yeah, they make people think they've got a choice, you know, where they really don't. And then you say, well, we need to compromise. It's been very much manipulated. The whole planet is very much manipulated in that way. But the remedy has to be, say, I have a continuity problem, because the problem that I see in the world is people keep getting fooled by this and thinking, no, I'm going to get on this side. But they end up realizing, then they realize, well, I got an opponent over there that's equally powerful, and then they struggle. Eventually, that causes the psyche to say, wait a minute, let's make a compromise, let's integrate, let's get this half-truth. You fall into the trap. So the whole thing is fueled by the continuity issue, by the fear of sudden abrupt awakening, where you just throw all this away. The entire thing is. So you have to work at it at that level. Otherwise, you're just pushing broom, just pushing stuff around. When you try to deal with it at the level of polarization, duality, and half-truth, half-truthness, you'll find you're just pushing stuff around. You push this over there, and then this gets pushed over there, then you get pushed back this way, and you're pushing. It's all on the same level. You have to get to the higher level where you recognize it's all being fueled by the continuity, fear of the continuity issue. And then see that the solution of the continuity issue, what that is. You have to do that. Otherwise, you will just be duped, continually duped, and frustrated, and just be burned out. Because deep down, the ego has leverage over us. If we don't solve the continuity problem, it will distort, give us distortions, and those distortions will be in control of our life. And even though we want to say, well, we want to win, we want to get rid of the bad guys, you'll end up as one of the bad people, one of the distorters, one of the half-truthers kind of thing, because you can't fight, get rid of these distortions that the ego gives you. You won't be able to get rid of them. You still have projection, anger, you know, all non-forgiveness, all this stuff, the whole thing. Very, very tough situation. Well, we're getting some interruptions now. Maybe it's time to wrap this third part up. We've gone over everything, and see, I don't have a payment problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a repayment problem. I have a continuity problem. People attract problems into their lives intentionally. They make problems for themselves and others intentionally, so they can feel, well, at least I have this problem. I need some problems. I'm afraid of having all my problems taken away from me. So again, we intentionally generate problems for ourselves. I can see it in people. They do it on purpose, and they don't. They rationalize it. No. It's all rationalized. Everybody does it. So I don't have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a situational problem. I have a continuity problem. And again, trying to solve other people's problems, it's endless. They'll just get another one, and another one, and another one. So you solve one, they solved that one. Okay, I need another one. And so they say, oh, please help me out with this problem. You know, to hide the fact that they actually, nobody's honest. They don't say, no, I don't want this problem. Help me out with it. That's a scam too. They do want the problems. People do want the problems they have. They just don't want the ones they have right now. They want some other ones. So it's a shuffling the deck. Say, well, I don't really want this one. Oh, but this one here looks a little better. Oh, this one's really painful. Oh, I need another one. You never break out of the cycle of problems. They just keep exchanging one for another, shuffling the deck constantly, pushing problems around. So in the world, we just push problems around, like shuffleboard. We're just pushing them around. But we never break through. Breakthrough into clarity about the whole situation. We just don't. But it's time. It's time to do that. And the only way is to, every day, you have to keep on making progress in that direction. Keep on making progress in that direction. But again, trying to solve the world's problems doesn't work. They will just get another problem. If you bring peace to a certain area, they'll find a conflict with somebody else. You get free of one problem, another one pops up immediately. You know, just absolutely. This is the whole dynamic. So that's why I say working at it from the standpoint of I have a continuity problem is really the only way to get leverage over the whole situation. Otherwise, you'll just spin your wheels. You spend your whole life trying to solve problems, and you realize you've got just as many problems as ever, if not more. But the vision of oneness doesn't have any problem with how the problems of the world dance. It doesn't make any difference as far as its effectiveness is concerned. It makes no difference. And this is our salvation, the fact that it doesn't make any difference how the dance of problems dance, the dance of forgetfulness dances, doesn't affect it, doesn't affect its effectiveness in the slightest bit. And so we will keep that in mind as we go forward, and hopefully you've managed to miss the Super Bowl. All right, very great. And we'll see how it goes.